You come to be obedient. You come to listen. You come to do as you bid us to do. Open our eyes, we might see your glory. Open our ears, we might hear your word, and prepare our hearts for the preaching of your word. Your people have come to hear a word, O God, but I may be filled instead of the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart will be acceptable in thy sight. O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. I ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
He is
able. Paul writes this letter to Timothy from prison, and it's around 67 AD. He encourages Timothy by assuring him that he has his continued love and prayers, and reminds Timothy of his spiritual heritage and responsibilities. Only those who persevere will reap the reward. As Paul encourages Timothy with these words, he also encourages us. We who are of the family of God, we who sometimes feel overwhelmed with life's tragedies and life's challenges, we must realize that through the cool and through the calm, as well as the hot and hasty, we have a Savior who is able. He is abundantly able. Ephesians 3:20 says, "Now unto him that is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we could ask or think." Abundant means marked by great, plenty, ample. Abounding occurred in abundance, ample, more than enough. Many Christians depend on their own strength, but when they depend on their own strength, they fail to trust God sufficiently. We must depend on God daily because he is abundantly able to fortify us against the stresses of life. Philippians 4:13 reminds us that I can do all things through Christ who strengthens us.
Yes.
When we try to do things on our own, we don't show that we have confidence in God. When we try to do what God said he would do, that means we don't really believe that he could do what he said he would do or could do. But I stand here to tell you that what he said he can do, he can do.
Amen.
Yes.
He is bountifully able.
Yes.
And God is able to make all grace abound towards you. Bountiful means liberal in bestowing gifts or favors, given or provided abundantly. Many people are tight-fisted with God and others. They want to keep everything for themselves. You need to understand, we cannot outgive the Lord. We must be generous with him and others. The Lord is bountifully able to supply all our needs. Philippians 4:19. But my God shall supply all your need according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus.
Right.
That's the word of the Lord. You can take it to the bank.
All right.
What he says he can do. He is lovingly able. Wherefore he is able also to save them to the uttermost that come unto God by him. Loving means affection. God so loved the world that he gave his only son to die on the cross for our sins.
Amen.
To be saved, we must come to God in repentance and faith, accepting the Lord Jesus Christ. No man can come unto the Father but by me, saith the Lord. The door is Jesus, if you want to reap eternal life. You can be saved because Christ died on the cross for you.
Yeah.
What happens in life, many of us hear what the Lord says, but do we really believe it? If we believe that God is able, I would think we would let him do what he said he would do.
Amen.
In other words, We ask God to do something, and then we try to do it ourselves. We ask God to take a burden from us, then we take it back. But if we're going to give it to him, we have to give it to him for him to work on it. And he will work on it on his own time. Now, I know that life has a way of beating us down. Life has a way of putting us in a corner. Sometimes, every time we try to do something right, wrong presents itself. We do it, and we had to keep doing it. We have to learn to hang in there.
Yes, yes.
Sometimes you had to do it more than once. You had to do it until it is done. But just know that it shall be done because God is the one that's able to do it. Sometimes God doesn't do what you ask him to do, because you have not done what he said you to do.
Amen.
You can't expect God to do what he said he'll do if you haven't done what he told you to do.
All right,
we want God to do what he says, but then we want to be fickle in what we say and do. We want to choose, pick and choose what we want to do. Yeah, God, I can do this. Yeah, God, you gave me a whole book of rules, 66 chapters. I can do some of this stuff. I can't do all this stuff. I'll do this if you do this. We try to bargain with the Lord. We said, Lord, I won't touch if you heal my body. But we make it doing other things. Look, Lord, I won't do this. See, you can't pick and choose the easy thing to do and then ask God to do the difficult thing.
Amen.
You need to say, Lord, I want you to do everything that you say you would do. Because I'm going to do everything you told me to do. And by the help of the Holy Spirit, I can do it. See, God does not ask you to do anything you can't do. Don't you know he knows all about it? When he asks you to do something, you can do what he asks you to do. You can do it. But you can't do it by yourself. And it's planned that it's on purpose. See, God blesses on purpose. When he gives you what he does, it on purpose. He said, yeah, I'm going to tell you to do it. I know. You can't do it by yourself. That's why I'm here. If you could do it by yourself, you wouldn't need me. Think about it. If you could do everything yourself, what would you need God for? It's a partnership. You do what God tells you to do, and he'll do what he said to do. Paul reminds us in Romans chapter 5, verse 8, but God commended his love toward us, and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. We need to remember that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. No matter what you're going through, God is able to carry you through.
Yes.
And my brothers and sisters, know that every time you need him, he shows up. Every time you need something, he supplies you. He never gets tired of serving us.
Mm-hmm.
So we ought not get tired of serving him. We want God to be at our beck and call. But we only want to serve God when it's convenient. We only want to serve God when there's nothing else to do. God ought not to be a second thought. He ought to be a first thought.
Yes.
God is not one that you serve by. I don't have anything. Well, I don't have anything else to do. I think I will read the Bible. I'm not busy now, so I think I will meditate on God's word. We should study God's word and meditate on his word first. Because doing so, he empowers us to do the thing that we now have on our agenda. Don't you know that if God said no, no matter how many times you said yes, it would never occur? You can't do anything if God says no. And the reason you're able to do what you do is because God allows you to do it. He is able not only now, but eternally. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Hebrews 13:8. This is important. Because man is fickle. Why do you say that, preacher? Well, you receive a blessing, you run in doing cartwheels. Something good happens, and you're shouting. But when nothing seemingly good happens, you're quiet. We need to worship God when things are going well and when they're not going well.
Amen.
We need to shout when we're being blessed and shout when it doesn't seem like we're being blessed. But when it seems like we're not being blessed, we're still being blessed because we're still here.
Yes.
And because we're still here, we're here ready, willing, and able to receive another blessing. We change from time to time. If we don't feel like doing something, we don't do it for the most part. Suppose God did not feel like doing something for us. We would be upset if God didn't always help us when we're in the need. But yet still, he asks us to do things that we don't do. But yet he still blesses. But just think, if he blesses us when we don't always do what he asks us to do, what do you think would happen if you tried your best to do what he asked you to do? What do you think would happen if you get up in the morning with your mind stayed on him? What would happen if you, before you sat down to the table to eat, you just gave God some glory?
Amen.
Even if you even if you had a long conversation with God and your food has lost some of its heat because you spent some time with the Lord, it's going to taste better anyhow because you've given God what he demands of us.
Mm-hmm.
He wants our time.
Yes.
He wants our praise.
Mm-hmm.
He wants our worship.
Yes.
He wants it not just because he can do stuff for us, but just because of who he is.
Yes.
Because he's God, we ought to worship him. Because he's God, we ought to give him glory.
That's
because
right.
he's God, that's enough to praise him.
Mm-hmm.
If he isn't doing anything, it's all right. He is still God. He's able to do abundantly more than we could ever hope for or ask.
Yes. Thank you, Lord.
And because of that, we need to let him know, Lord, we love you. We thank you, Lord. We glorify you. We magnify you.
Yes, sir.
We thank you that you are the same.
Yes, yes.
People change from day to day. They're here today and going tomorrow. You never know where to find them. When you need them, the phone is busy. When you get the number, it's the wrong number. They change the number on you. But God stays the same. He's always available.
Yes.
He never leaves us nor forsakes us.
Yes.
And he is eternally able to stand by us and sustain us.
Yes, he is.
Cast our burdens upon the Lord and he shall sustain thee.
Yes.
He will never ever suffer the righteous to be moved. I love the way God does things. Because I've never, ever needed him, and he's not showed up. Never. When you think about it, there were times when you needed God, and he showed up on time. Why? Because he loves us. And he wants us to know that if you do this, I'll do this. I am convinced that the more we do for Jesus, the happier we're going to be.
Mm-hmm.
The more we do for him, the better things will look for us. The world is in the shape that it's in because folk have turned their back on the Lord. They turned their back on the church. We are no longer the strong people we used to be. Because we have allowed the world to dictate what we say and do. If the church says this, we're going with what somebody else says. And the sad thing about it is that there are people who won't stand up for right. If something is wrong and you don't stand for right, you're just bad as the person who's doing the wrong.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, when you see things going on that you know is against God, you ought to say something.
Amen.
You ought to speak up. You ought to say, that's wrong. That's wrong. The world, anytime you supposedly have an intelligent human being, and they don't know what to say out of their mouths, and they're running for the president of the United States, we have come to a sad state when somebody like Donald Trump can stand up there and do what he is doing and call himself running for the president of the United States. And guess what? Folk following him. Folk believing that stuff. You know why? Because they've always felt that way. They just needed somebody to champion their thoughts. If Donald Trump, it'll never happen. But if anybody like him ever got into a position of leadership in government, we're in trouble. He didn't have a, and see, Donald Trump is not stupid. He what he is doing is purposeful. He can control his mouth. He doesn't want to control his mouth because he got too many people who believe in what he's saying. And if people weren't following him, he would stop doing it. We're in bad shape. When the church has no voice, the people of God have no voice. Everybody doing what they want to do. People, Lord have mercy. If some of our grandparents were here, they would shake their heads at the things that they see that are happening in this world.
Amen.
The things that are going on in society. It's just bad. But guess what? It's going to get worse before it gets better. We have to be prepared and not let the evil of the world overtake us. Know that God is able to stop all this. God is able to put a halt to it. But he wants us to do our part. He wants us to stand up and tell somebody about the saving grace of Jesus Christ. He wants the family to get more involved in Christian activities. He wants parents to talk to their children about God, talk to their grandchildren about God, but more importantly, show God. I saw God in my house through my folk. That's how I became attached. If my people didn't believe, I wouldn't believe. If they didn't go to church, I wouldn't go to church. So you have to set the example for others to follow. Things are not lost. There's hope. Because without hope, we might as well give it up. But we just have to be on guard, be on duty, and know that God is able. God has done it through the years. He's done it through the ages. Prophets and folk of men and women of God have carried the word, and they've done what needed to be done to change the mindset of people. But I want you to know that there's one person who's able to do everything that you need to be done, and that's our Lord Jesus. I know he's able. I know he's able because he was with Daniel in the lion's den. Mm-hmm. Y'all remember that story? I know he's able. He was with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego while they were in the fiery furnace. I know he's able. He was with Moses and he parted the Red Sea. I know he's able. He was with David when he slew Goliath. I know he's able. He was with Jonah in the belly of the great fish. I know he's able. He was with Christ on the cross and is able to help us now. Whatever your situation is, God is able. If you're sick, he can heal your body.
All right.
If you're bound, he'll set you free. If your mind needs regulating, he's a mind regulator. He's a hope taker. He will do what you need. He's able to do all that you ask. He's able to keep you. If you're falling down, put your hand in God's hand and allow him to pick you up. He is. I'll say he's able.